Please speak directly into the microphone. That's a big sign. Try to do that. I am thrilled to be here in this room back in St. Augustine. I want to thank Mrs. Duncan for having me. Mrs. Duncan's daughter for a lovely introduction, Mayor Bowles, and Senator Hill, Dr. Haley, all of you in San Francisco here in St. Augustine. I would like to indulge me to repeat one surprise welcome to my old boss. 40 years ago, I worked for George Bush.
It was a movement that gave freedom to everyone.
drew upon the wells of the scripture and the Constitution. Dr. King put one foot in the scriptures and one foot in the patriotic documents to say, take your pick, equal souls or equal voters. Either tribute, either legacy that we profess is where we are trying to lead this whole nation. And that movement is, number one, a movement that liberated everyone, made it possible for all of us in this room. Every breath you've taken for the last couple of hours has been free because of leadership from that period. Because I guarantee you, if we were sitting here in the atmosphere that prevailed 40 years ago, you would not be free. You would all have sweaty palms about what was going to happen and who might get arrested or who might lose their jobs on the basis of the oppression that gripped everyone, white and black, oppressors and oppressees in that period. And white people have been liberated every bit as much as black people by the witness of that movement. Not only white people in general, but if you are the mother or the father or the brother of a woman who has grown up since that movement, you stand on the shoulders of the civil rights movement, white or black, because opportunities, when people started struggling with the meaning of equal souls and equal votes, it began to seep everywhere and open doors for women who had been constricted in their careers and in their opportunities. When I went to the University of North Carolina in 1964, most people don't believe this, by state law, women could not go to the state university unless they were nursing students. Chapel Hill, North Carolina was 5% female. All of that changed and was swept aside. Doors opened everywhere, not only in the Ivy League, but in the West Point. It was beyond people's imagination that women might be able to serve in the military. I have all these things opened up. This is a legacy of the civil rights movement. It's a legacy of freedom for everyone. So it's not selfish. The civil rights leaders, I call them modern founders. They were doing exactly what the founders of our country did. They were confronting systems of subjugation and injustice and setting in motion the great healing ties of equal citizenship. And in that sense, they are and should be recognized as modern founding fathers. And number two, aside from the fact that it was not a selfish movement, it's not a movement about the clean past. It's a movement about the future. Because if this country needs to confront intractable problems, which we certainly do in this day and age, where are we going to reach for the values and the spirit and the enterprise and the deep sustenance to be able to confront these problems? Into our heritage, into the same well of courage and intellectual vigor and rigor that animated that movement 40 years ago. It was a challenge to the spirit and to the intellect, all night meetings, what are we going to do next? It was not easy. The movement was about inner conflict, constantly. And therefore, if we're going to meet the challenges that confront this nation today, economically, spiritually, politically, militarily, every other way, we need to keep the lesson of the civil rights movement ever not just before us, but in our deepest respect, because it will challenge all of us. Dr. King, surprisingly enough, used to quote James Madison all the time. Why? Because he considered James Madison the architect of democracy, and he wanted to dig in the wells of democracy. Madison said, politics, properly understood, is the most profound meditation on human nature. And when you're in a struggle like that, you've got to figure out what makes people tick across the board. And that's what the movement did. Now, I came to St. Augustine in the middle of a 24-year travail to write these three volumes. It was supposed to be one volume. It was supposed to take 3 years. It took three volumes in 24 years, which I never could have told my mother or my publisher when I started. But halfway through this, I came down, and David Nolan gave me a tour somewhat like the tour we took today, except there weren't any monuments of it. It was trying to find people to talk to. Going back to the period in 1963, I have a chapter in Pillar of Fire about Lyndon Johnson speaking in this very room. It caused a crisis that in the politics of that age was muffled. The crisis was all going on behind the scenes, and And they finally, because Lyndon Johnson wrote a letter in answer to Dr. Haven saying, no event that I participate in when I come to St. Augustine to get ready for the 400th anniversary coming up will be segregated. But they're having this luncheon here. So then it caused a crisis, and Johnson people said, you've got to have at least some color folks there. That's the way they talked back then. And the city of St. Augustine said, well, yes, but they will be our guests. They can't pay their way. And that caused a crisis because Dr. Haven's people didn't want to be guests. They didn't want to be for free. They wanted to be there on the same basis as everyone else. Wound up that there was a small table back there, and I guarantee you there was some sweating palms. And Vice President Johnson came in. The deal was, behind the scenes, that the city council would meet the next day with a delegation of African Americans from St. Augustine to discuss forming a biracial commission. And in the politics of that time, every white politician, and this was just a fact of life, had to deal with the notion that if you had a biracial commission, literally sitting down with a person of another race, it was a surrender. It was a surrender to white folks, and you couldn't get a collective. Therefore, the next day after that banquet that Lyndon Johnson was here, he's gone. They had the meeting, and I love the phrase because it's in the records. I found the records out in Washington. They called it an informal conference with local citizens and city manager Charles F. Barry. I don't know if any of his relatives are here or not, but Mr. Barry, the city manager in City Hall, showed up for the meeting, but then he left, and the only thing in the meeting was a tape recorder left on the table. Because it was too big a risk for any white person to sit there, the tape recorder was there and said, record your grievances. And around that table sat Dr. Haley, Reverend J.H. McKissy, Clyde Jenkins, the barber, amazing barber, J.D. Proctor, and Roscoe Hallier. And they talked into a microphone. They said, why can't we get together? Why can't we at least talk face to face? That's March 1963. In May 1963, the amazing thing about the civil rights movement in St. Augustine that I would like to leave to you, if there's one idea about it, is that it affected the civil rights movement nationally, and the national civil rights movement affected St. Augustine. And most people are not aware of how that works, but that's how history moves. People in local areas move with national things in mind, and national things happen on the basis of things that take place in local areas. That was in March 1963 when Johnson was here. It was in May of 63 that Dr. King, the biggest gamble of his entire career, allowed those 6 and 8 year old girls to march in Birmingham. And it melted the resistance of the whole country and indeed the world, photographs of those little kids being rolled down the street by the fire hoses. It was in the wake of that that Dr. Haley and the NAACP Youth Council had the first demonstrations that happened in St. Augustine IV and incarcerated for the balance of 1963. That ramped up the whole presence of that. It was a national event that had sparks here in St. Augustine, that sparked in St. Augustine and then sparked back a year later into the national platform. Now, how it happened in St. Augustine, is of a pattern also with things that happened elsewhere. The local committees to move here in St. Augustine are traditional, and they basically felt that there was too much at stake to risk very much here. Dr. Haley comes from a family with a lot of wonderful degrees. There are people with Stanford and Yale, and his daughter married somebody who went to Dartmouth. This is the first generation of people who have those things at stake. If you were a white family and you were the grandson of somebody who had gone to Harvard, you would feel that going to jail would put that at stake. But if you had never had it in your family's whole heritage, you would be risking that much more. And therefore, when Dr. Haley wanted to do more and wanted to have sit-ins and demonstrations, his NAACP people were not particularly happy about it. I don't know how much he talks about it, but I'm going to tell you, if you go into the NCAA, NAACP papers, they considered Dr. Hickman a troublemaker in a black civil rights group, let alone on the other side of town. They didn't want him to do anything with what he was doing. They were trying to figure out ways to shut him down. They didn't like him. And that happened time after time. When the Montgomery bus boycott started, earlier than that, in the 1950s, the local civil rights organizations were so paralyzed by the prospect of something new that they had to form a new organization, the Montgomery Improvement Organization. That was a fact of civic life. Civic life is generally designed to preside over calm and politeness. Social change is about transforming calm and politeness into a higher one, and it is never, it needs a midwife. Dr. David may not be a midwife in real life, but he was a midwife of this movement, and therefore he had to defy his own people in the civil rights movement. A few months later, with the St. Augustine Four still in jail, and just after the March on Washington, 1963. One famous date, one slightly trivia date for you and St. Augustine about the March on Washington, August 28, 1963. It was on August 28, 1565, that Adelantado Menendez sighted the harbor right behind us. August 28 is the feast day for St. Augustine, because he died on August 28 in the year 430. That's a long time ago, the year 430. But because it was his feast day when he sighted land, fear after fearing that he wasn't ever going to sight any land, he said, I'm naming this St. Augustine. That same day, August 28, St. Augustine's feast day, was the day of the March on Washington 399 years later. After the oldest city had been founded, and it was only 3 weeks after the amazing March on Washington that stupefied this country in ways that historians tend to cover up because we want to tweet talk every day. The March on Washington terrified white America. I will give you just a couple of examples before you. Washington, D.C. canceled all liquor sales for the first time since Prohibition. The federal government sent every employee home on home leave, especially the women. They stockpiled plasma. The Pentagon had 15,000 soldiers surrounding the suburbs. The D.C. courts not only banned liquor sales, but they stockpiled, the hospitals were ready to deal with people, and they had stockades ready to hold up to 5,000 arrested people. American society could not imagine a large number of black people congregating anywhere in this United States and without rivers of bloodshed and virtual Armageddon. The reason that the March on Washington is known as a patriotic picnic is because it was such an amazing relief against what people in our racial fears had projected and feared was going to happen. So it was a very happy event. People said this is like a Grant Wood painting. This is like Ma and Pa Kettle. Everybody's happy again. Church bombing occurred in Birmingham on September 15th. It was that week, and I am convinced, and I don't know whether Dr. is right here. He can speak for himself. But to have that searing event, four little girls blown up in a church on a Sunday morning, 3 weeks after the stunning event of the March on Washington had convinced half of America that the race issue is no longer with us, and thank goodness we don't have to worry about that anymore, was a body blow to the soul of people, and there were demonstrations all over the United States. My friend Diane Nash of the Freedom Riders stayed up all night that night breaking furniture because she had been responsible for pushing Dr. King to let those kids march in Birmingham. And because of that, she knew it was the right thing, but she felt responsible for the death of those four little girls. And by the next morning, she and her husband had the blueprint saying, we will answer this by shutting down Alabama until it allows every black person to vote in Alabama, and presented to Dr. King the blueprint for what became the Selma movement. The next morning, the remarkable thing, again, about this movement is that the victims of Democratic failures nevertheless assumed the responsibility as Democratic citizens for designing liberation for themselves and their own oppressor. The Diane Nash took this plan to Dr. King, and she hounded him about it for 18 months until they went into Selma. He said, Diane, we can't, we've been fighting for 10 years to get a segregation bill before Congress. We finally got it there. We can't say, well, we changed our mind. We want to do voting rights. And she says, people are willing to give their lives for this. Leadership must provide an outlet for nonviolent people who are willing to struggle for justice. And she hounded him. Dr. King's father, Andy Young, said that when Diane got on you, some of you are old enough here to remember the Humphrey Bogart movie, The African Queen, in which he went down the river in Africa with Catherine Hepburn, and the leeches got on him down in the river, and he went crazy with the leeches. And he said, that's the way Diane got on, like those leeches. She got on Dr. King about doing voting rights act. But what hit Dr. Haley was he's got people still in jail, and this thing, what are we going to do here in St. Augustine? We've got people in jail nobody's paying any attention to. It's not in the news. It's just a fact of life. These are only four young black kids. They can stay. They can stay in jail. So somehow, one day, he's going to tell you exactly how, he decided that the thing for him to do, in the spirit of this church bombing, in the spirit of this mobilization that has taken hold of the whole country since Birmingham, is to go to a Klan rally. Out in the countryside in the middle of the night with Clyde Jenkins, the barber, and two other fellows, and they went out there, and I am so thankful that once again, in the NAACP records, you can find that there was a white minister who had also gone there just to see it. But of course, he had better cover because he was white, and his record, his description of what occurred in the Klan rally when they captured Dr. Hayden, beat out his windshield, and tore up all the car, and marched them in right at the time that Connie Lynch, an internationally famous person, was preaching to the Klan rally. And they carried them in, and he had just said to the Klan rally that he hoped that they could kill Dr. Hale. And I'm just going to give you one moment to recapture the atmosphere of some of what this was like. The minister who was there undercover recorded what was said, and therefore gives us validation not only of Dr. Haley's description of what happened afterwards, after he barely survived and was beaten up, but a description that of the entire event. Connie Lynch arrived in the pink Cadillac wearing his trademark string tie, whipped up the Klan rally, and said that the Klan was on the move to destroy the worldwide conspiracy of Negroes and Jews. Some of you say, but Jesus was a Jew, he said. That just goes to show you how these cotton-picking, half-witted preachers have fooled you. Jesus wasn't no Jew, he was a white man. Then, believe it or not, he started talking about the Birmingham church bombing, which I believe was part of the motivation for Dr. Haley to show up there in the first place. He said, those girls, remind you, this is only 4 days later, those girls were old enough to have venereal diseases and were no more human or innocent than rattlesnakes, he said, so I had to kill them all. And it's four less so-and-sos tonight. Then good for whoever planted the bomb. We're all bad off. Dr. Haley marched into a Klan rally with people talking like that a few miles from here, only 40 years ago. Barely survived. Now, in that atmosphere with St. Augustine and the National Civil Rights Movement kind of interacting with one another, it went on until through the Kennedy assassination, and in 1964 was the great pivotal year. Now, I didn't get to talk to Dr. Haley. I chased him all over. I chased people 24 years on this thing. I didn't find it. I don't know whether you didn't want to talk to me or whether I just didn't do anything right. But I made a mistake because the catalyzing event in February 1964, when they shot his dog through the door, I got it right that it was a 30 caliber bullet. It wasn't a shotgun. 30 caliber bullets would go through all the walls and low and kill this dog. What I put in this dog was a bulldog, and I want to apologize because his dog was a boxer. A boxer named Madonna. And when that happened, that was when Dr. Hammond said, this is too much. They're burning people, they're firebombing people, they're shooting into the house. I've got to appeal to Martin Luther King. We need some help. Now, the true reality of what happened is that by this time, Dr. King had been through, finished with what he called being a fireman. That is, being called to everybody's movement and showing up and getting blamed when things didn't go wrong. So Dr. King did not immediately say, I better get on my horse and go to St. Augustine. No, he sent people to investigate. And a number of them said, those people in St. Augustine aren't well enough organized yet. There's too much division. The NAACP people don't like Dr. Hayden. They don't want to do anything. He's isolated. So Dr. King sent Hosea Williams down here. Now, I know Hosea Williams pretty well. And I'm trying to imagine Hosea Williams and Dr. Hayden together. Because Hosea Williams was a fellow World War II vet. He had another plate in his head from an injury in Germany. And everybody in the movement always said, when he proposed to do something crazy or suicidal, that the metal plate was vibrating in his head, and he didn't really know what he was doing. But when he got here to St. Augustine, he's trying to convince Dr. Hayden to be not that the answer to these bullets, these 30 caliber bullets that had killed his boxer, was to be nonviolent. That was the heart of the movement, and that the movement was nonviolent because nonviolence is at the heart not only of Jesus' witness, but at the heart of democracy. Why? Because what is democracy but a cathedral of votes? And what is the vote but a piece of nonviolence? And therefore, when you're in a nonviolent movement, you are on the vanguard of advancing democracy by creating goodwill that can mobilize power and citizenship. But that speech is hard to do and hard to be convincing when you're on the brunt of violence and you're facing the Klan. So they had a really hard time doing it. And it wasn't until a couple of months later, when Dr. King was basically trying not to come into St. Augustine, the Civil Rights Bill was being filibustered. He didn't want to start a new movement. He wanted to just keep the pot boiling until the Civil Rights Bill got passed. And he sent Andy Young down here to tell Hosea to chill out those folks in St. Augustine. And I talked to both Andy and Hosea about it, a meeting in the church in May. This is after Mrs. Peabody, who was also, Dr. King said, I don't want to go to St. Augustine, get some of those folks from New England. And that's why Mrs. Peabody was here, because Dr. King didn't want to come. And a couple of months later, he's got Andy down here, and Andy is in the front of the church to tell Hosea that Dr. King has just instructed me to calm things down here. And they're standing in the front of the church, and both of them told me the exact same story, that Andy is telling Hosea, we're not going to have a movement here, and that Hosea threw up his hands at pretending that he had convinced Andy to do exactly the opposite, and threw up his hands and said, that's great, Andy, I want the prettiest girl in this church to march with you downtown tonight. And as soon as those marches started, that's what kicked off the whole movement. And it was only the next night that Andy, who had never gone to jail, and Andy was a guy in hush puppies who was a church bureaucrat who believed in being nice to folks. And it was here that he was baptized by leading that march downtown, because Hosea had tricked him into it. And the next thing you know, Dr. King is down here. And this became the final witness to keep the civil rights movement alive and on the front page just long enough to get the bill passed. Dr. King went to jail the day after the Senate filibuster was broken. The first time in a century. June 10th. The bill passed on June 19th. In between that time, there were marches here, and every day it was on the front page. Those were when the weigh-ins were going. The significance of St. Augustine was that Dr. King said, And Dr. Having said even more, because Dr. King was desperately still trying to make a deal to get the Civil Rights Bill without having to get killed in St. Augustine. Dr. Having said, if we let up the pressure, they will say we don't need the Civil Rights Bill. We were always constantly looking for a reason to say that it didn't happen, and we didn't get it. But this, again, this is the service of St. Augustine, that it was the front page headline that nudged America in the final days of passing that bill. First, breaking the Senate filibuster, then passing the Senate, and then it was on, you know, July 2nd that it passed the House, and Johnson signed it the same day because he was afraid that if he didn't sign it the same day, there would be more demonstrations in St. Augustine and all hell would break loose. He signed it instantly because he wanted to establish the landmark in a way that could change the atmosphere and change us. It was in that period, one of my favorite quotes, a great journalist interviewed Dr. King, and said that he had been told by the white citizens of St. Augustine that if Dr. King would simply get rid of Dr. Haley, who was a thorn in everybody's side, that they might agree to have a biracial commission. All this violence, all the weigh-ins, all everything else, they're still talking about a biracial commission because it was still seen by any white person as an embarrassment and as a humiliation to be the one that agreed to talk to a black person. That was still the atmosphere at that time. Here's what Dr. King told the journalists. This is the old story we find every place, he said. They never want to deal with a local man who began the movement because invariably he is a true leader and a dynamic force in the community. What it really means is that they don't want to deal with anybody they can't control. We went through this in Birmingham with Fred Shelton. Dr. Haven, I know you've got many tributes and many compliments. But to be compared to Fred Shuttlesworth is a great tribute. I got to give his eulogy in Birmingham. Shuttlesworth, who I interviewed and is an amazing leader. I'm not going to say I gave the only eulogy because that service lasted 9 hours. It was an amazing thing. But to have Dr. Martin Luther King say that you are like Fred Shuttlesworth and you are a true leader in the community.
Talked about the heroes and she was. They are the example. They
be example for all of us who are white today, to be able to find it in our hearts, to take an African-American leader as leaders of our own cause. They're our leaders. They're our patriotic leaders of that period. But I want to show you just a tiny glimmer on the other side. The biggest surprise when I interview, when I talk to young high school students today about civil rights here, is that they find it shocking that even the libraries were segregated, that black kids could not go in the library. They are not shocked at all, and this saddens me, that the churches were segregated. But on July 1st, with the Civil Rights Bill about to pass the next day and be signed the next day, the bishop, the Episcopal bishop, Hamilton West of Florida, came to St. Augustine to meet the Trinity Episcopal. Now, all the leaders of Trinity of St. Augustine, or many of them, were members there. The vestry had fired its minister, Charles Seymour, because he told them that they had to admit black worshipers, not because of the civil rights law, but because of Christianity. The bishop is on the spot, and he tells them, outside agitators that caused this problem, I really sympathize with you, and so on and so forth. And believe it or not, the members of the vestry who were there told the bishop that what they were worried about was that white people in St. Augustine would think that they had been too encouraging of black people, and therefore no white people would come in. It's just like when Dr. King and Dr. Hayden went to jail in the Bronx outside the Monson Motor Lodge. Mr. Brock put up the Confederate flag and went on TV to say we are still segregated, because what he was worried about was white people thinking that he was too sympathetic. So now you have the bishop meeting with the vestry. They are in the church. And they are saying the Civil Rights Bill doesn't cover churches. We can still be segregated. And we don't want to look like we're too eager to have black folks here, because then we'll lose our white membership. And Hoopy Tebow, the editor of the newspaper, stood up and said, Bishop, we got to cut to the chase. Are you saying here, as bishop of our church, that we must enforce the entrance of Negroes to the church if they want to come here and worship? The bishop said, yes, that is the question. Hoopy Tebow said, then you are facing me with a choice to be an American or an Episcopalian. Now, that's sad, because what he's saying is that to be an American means to resist this, because in his view of being an American, you couldn't be forced go to church with somebody else. Tebow said, Bishop, must we provoke you to excommunicate us if we choose to be Americans and not Episcopalians? And the bishop looked at them and said, I have wrestled with this. I have only one thing to say. You must be excommunicated, or you must be converted to a new meaning of American and a new meaning of Episcopalian. The bishop, in a very, very small way, rose to a moment. But every one of us needs to have those moments to expand the freedom that was won at so great a cost here. St. Augustine is not at the forefront of historical memory about the civil rights movement, in part because the Civil Rights Bill was the culmination of everyone's focus, in part because the most violent times in St. Augustine. Dr. King said that the night of June 25th, 1964, was the worst night he ever saw in the whole Civil Rights Movement. 40 people went into the hospital and were beaten, and the New York Times reporter said that white people tore the clothes off the backs of black women out in the street, and that you could hear the thuds of clubs from two blocks away. Don't ever sugarcoat this movement. It was rough. It has lifted us to a higher place. It does not have the historical stature that it should have because of the national events and because it coincided with Mississippi Freedom Summer, which became the dominant news story of that time. But it is there. It should be part of your larger history. You have an amazing opportunity here, in my view, as the oldest city in the nation, with so many cultural strands here, of Catholicism, of the United States in its earliest period, and then of the Civil Rights Movement in its critical time here, that your historical mission, you know, from a glorious win like this, can lift and enrich the whole country. The harder the barriers you cross, the wider the base you stand on. No place stands on a broader base than St. Augustine. Do not worry about your stature in the national scheme of things, because it will come in time. Not long ago, I went to Birmingham, a city that let loose some of the tides that affected here us. And a city councilman, a white city councilman, said, I've been to segregationist all my life. And after the Civil Rights Movement, I resented it for 40 years because it painted us as demons and evil. And he said, only in the last year, he said, I voted to have you come here and talk about civil rights. He said, my family thinks I've lost my mind. He said, but I have decided that the blister of my heart against the Civil Rights Movement is not worth the lesson that we are all larger for what we went through. St. Augustine will get that moment too. You will be lifted up in history. You deserve to be lifted up in history. You are resonant with history, and it's a history that's alive with personal discovery and with hope and a bright future from the movement that taught us that through sacrifice and study and togetherness, we can lift this country up to the best meaning of our own professed values. Thank you, Dr. Haley, and thank you all for this meeting.